Hi there folks, today's video is back to basics. It's about how to deal with common errors in Power Automate Cloud Flows. So I'm going to demonstrate the errors you see on screen right now with this flow that I've built, but also we're going to take a look at JSON and some of the fundamentals of understanding the flow history, the inputs and the outputs, enabling you to better debug your failing flows. So I'm going to start this demonstration off in Excel because it helps us understand the fundamentals of the data that comes into and out of our cloud flows. And I have a basic table in Excel containing four columns, name, age, date of birth, and email, and 10 rows from John all the way down to Ava. And I'm going to call out Jane Smith as well. She hasn't got an age, so we'll later look at how to deal with empty strings in our expressions. So over on the right-hand side, you'll see that I have what looks like the input and output data. This is a JSON array. And we know it's an array because it's got an opening square bracket and a closing square bracket. And then within that, we have two objects, object one and object two. And within each of those objects, we have key value pairs. So name and John Doe is a key and a value. Looking over on the left-hand side again at our table, this very much represents an array of data. This is what comes into our Power Automate Cloud Flows. And by looking at the data over on the right-hand side, we can start to understand how that's built up. So what I have highlighted right now, the whole table, that is represented by an array, those opening and closing square brackets at the start and at the end. If I highlight John Doe, that's the equivalent of a row or a record, which is an object. And an object is represented by an opening squiggly and a closing squiggly bracket. And then you'll see at the end of this particular squiggly bracket, there is a comma that indicates that there will be another row. And in which case, this particular array has two objects, one for John and one for Jane. When I pick out name and John Doe, that's a key and a value. So for each column, in this case, we've got name and we've got a value, which is John Doe. You need to have those key value pairs. So when we jump into Jane, she's got name and Jane Smith. So again, name is the key, the value is Jane Smith. If we have a look at her age being the key, the value being an empty string, this is how the data is represented in Power Automate Cloud Flows. So the other thing to note is we have different data types. So the values that come through into your Cloud Flows can be represented as strings, they can be represented as integers, objects, arrays. And in this particular scenario, John Doe is in double quotes, therefore he is a string, or his output is a string, his value is a string. Same with age at the moment, that is also a string, 25. If you were to ever see a number come through without quotes around it, you'll know that it's most likely an integer data type. You also get Boolean as well, so true and false. Typically, they do not have quotes around them. They are represented as the word true or the word false. Those are data types. And so now we're going to jump back into Power Automate and have a look at the flow that went dramatically wrong for me. And I'm going to start by looking at the get a row action. The thing I want to call out first off is the inputs and the outputs. And these are crucial for you understanding what's gone right or wrong with your flow. The inputs for an action relate to what was provided into that action at the point of runtime. So any of the parameters that you've set, like the sheet name or some of the filter options for that action, you'll be able to see in the inputs. Less exciting for get a row, but more exciting for the filter array, which we'll look at later on. The outputs, if we scroll down, is what's come out of that action, because of course we've run something and data has come out, and that's what we then use in the dynamic content of our next actions. So when we have a look at the show raw outputs, we can see the data that's come back in the form of this key that's called the body. And that key has got a value of which the value is an object, which is a single record. So by using the action get a row, we've returned a single row from our Excel spreadsheet in this case, and we can also identify the fact that an object is returned in those squiggly brackets. And then whilst there are some system keys, like the data context and data etag, there are also the specific details of that table in the form of the name, the age, the date of birth, and the email. Now, the eagle-eyed will have already noticed that the date of birth has come through as a serial number. We'll take a look at that later on. Now, if we jump into list rows by comparison, this is an action that returns plural. So it's not one row, it's multiple rows. And therefore, the output for us is going to be even more interesting because, first of all, we have a key called body, which is an object. And then we have a value, which is again another key within that object. But the value of that value is an array. So if you remember when we had a look at that Excel table earlier on, the data that comes back as an array. So if we are looking at the body value, we are getting an array back into our dynamic content. And it's here that for each of the objects, we have those key values and we can see the multiple rows. So hopefully now we're starting to understand how the history is important, how it's interesting to understand the different data types, the different structures, and then also why sometimes we might get some of these error messages that I'm about to show in the next part of this video. So the first thing I want to do is look at this error message from compose add one to an age. And all I'm trying to do is to add the number one to their age. And the error message we're getting is the template language function add expects its second parameter to be an integer or a decimal number. The provided value is of type string. So we can see already it's important to understand the data types. And so when we have a look at the expression later on, we'll be able to understand why we're providing a string here when indeed we want to have an integer and how we can resolve it. If I jump back up into get a row and have a look at those raw outputs, we can see that their age is in quotes. And because it's in quotes, we know it's a string. So if I'm trying to add a number to a string, we're going to get an error message, of course. Can't add a number to a string. The compose format date of birth, we have an error message that says the function format date time, the value provided for the date time string 36387 was not valid. The date time string must match ISO 8601 format. So I do have more detailed videos on how to deal with dates and how to remove weekends and public holidays, etc., using an array and filters and to do it as efficiently as possible without an apply to each. But the thing to understand here, of course, is this serial number that comes back from Excel is not a date time string, and a valid date time string is the year, the month, and the date. So we can change that, and I'll show you again later as we progress through this video. Then we go into the filter array action, and the filter array action has given me an error message to say that the from property value in the query action inputs is of type object. The value must be an array. Okay, so we are providing an object into this filter array. Of course, the action is about filtering arrays. Therefore, we need to supply an array as an input. When we had a look at that list rows present in a table and we had a look at that show raw outputs, we could see that body was an object, but value is an array based on those square brackets. So again, hopefully these things are starting to make sense, and please let me know in the comments if this is helping you understand how to diagnose and build out your flows in Power Automate. So if we go into edit, and the first thing I want to do is to have a look at the compose add one to age, and if we have a look at the add expression, all I'm doing, like I mentioned, is to add one to the body age. If you've never written an expression before, I'll delete that expression, and all I'm doing is typing in add an opening bracket, the autocomplete puts in a closing bracket, and then you can see that the expression is looking for number one and number two. So number one is literally a number one, but the dynamic content is based on their age. And the unfortunate thing is we know that age is a string and we need to resolve that. So the way to resolve that is to convert it into an integer. And we can go to the beginning of that expression, type in int with an opening bracket, go to the end of that expression, put a closing bracket, and now we're going to ensure that we're adding one to another integer by converting that string into an integer. And we can update that and check that out shortly. The compose format date of birth, the format date of time, is just taking the outputs of get a row body date of birth, and it's providing this specified format because I didn't want it in the traditional format. I want it in the UK format with a full string for the month. And those uppercase M's are for months. If you're using lowercase M's, that's for minutes. Four M's gives you the full string for the month. Two M's give you the number, and three M's give you the short string. I don't need to change this expression because the error is not actually in this expression, it's based on the data source. If, however, you did have a string from a different locale, then you can use an expression called parseDateTime. If I just remove this briefly, parseDateTime, if we put in an open close, it will convert a string into ISO 8601 based on a specific locale or into your own format, but you can provide that locale as part of a string. Definitely worth exploring that expression if you've got dates in a local format. So if I put the expression back to the way it was, and if we have a look at get a row, the problem that we're experiencing is down to the datetime format, which is one of the advanced parameters of get a row and also list rows present in the table. You can either retrieve it as a serial number or as an ISO 8601. So by changing that format that comes back into our flow, the format datetime is then able to format that date into the new format that I have requested. Then we move across onto the filter array, and we have the from is equal to the body, and then we're doing a filter where the name is equal to John Doe. And of course, that should look at the whole array and retrieve back the row for John Doe. Now we got an error to say that the from input parameter was an object and we needed to supply an array. And when we looked at the output history of the list rows present in a table, we could see that body was indeed an object, but body value was an array or a table of data. So I have incorrectly inserted body here as the input parameter. It's not an array, it's an object. So I can go back into my dynamic content and choose body value. And now we should be able to understand when we're referring to body value, in this case, it's the body value of the list rows present in the table. By looking at that history and the output of list rows present in the table, we're able to determine that the body value is indeed an array. And of course, our filter array action will work. So we can save and test that. And we can see that everything is now completed successfully as expected. Our add to date, we can see that we've output the number 26. The compose format date of birth, we've got the correct date, the 15th of August 1999. And the filter array, if we have a look at the input, and this is where I mentioned earlier on that the input gets a bit more exciting for the filter array. We've provided an array as input. And of course, I had a filter where their name was equal to John Doe. So what do we expect when we see the output from this? I click on the output. Again, we have an array because we're filtering array. The output will be an array, but then we have within that array, in this case, a single object, which is a single row or record within that array of data. And this is where we could combine the first expression to get the first object from an array based on the body of the filter array action. And therefore, if I wanted to get the name, as in John Doe, or the age, I could easily write an expression like the one you see on screen right now that demonstrates how to get the first object from the body of the filter array and specifically retrieve the name or the age as a key, which will then return the value as a result of evaluating that expression. Now, if we jump back onto that Excel sheet one more time, I had Jane Smith and Jane Smith had no age. So I'd like to go and create one more error for you and show you how we can deal with that scenario. Back over onto the flow and into edit, I'm going to go into get a row, and rather than searching for John, I'm going to search for Jane, and we'll test this flow and see what error message we might get. So not surprisingly, that particular action has now failed, and we can see that the template language function int was invoked with a parameter that is not valid. The value cannot be converted to the target type. And so what that ultimately means is int is trying to convert an empty string into an integer. It can't, therefore it fails. How are we going to deal with the scenario where we haven't got a number, we can't convert it into an integer, and we still want to be able to add a number to it? Well, let's see if we can build out an if expression. So back into edit, I'll click on the expression, and it's here that we want to insert an if expression. And basically we're going to check to see if it's empty, provide a value, otherwise use the dynamic value. So I'll insert if with an opening bracket. I'll then type in empty, because we want to check to see if something is empty with an opening bracket. The value that we're looking to check to see if is empty is based on the expression that I've just highlighted. So at the end of that expression, we want to insert a closing bracket followed by a comma. And you can see now we have the if expression asking us for the value if true, which we can insert in double quotes. And in this case, I'm going to provide the value 0. And then if I put in a comma, it's now asking for the value if false. And if, of course, it's not empty, then we want the dynamic content of their age. And just to finish things off, because we have the overall if statement, I need to insert another closing bracket. And now we should have our expression that we'll evaluate to see if, first of all, that age is empty. If that's true, then we'll use the string 0. If it's false, we'll use the dynamic value for the age. It will convert it into an integer, and then it will add the number 1, and we'll be able to proceed with that expression without any future error messages. So I'll hit update, we can save, and we can test. And we can see now in the output history for our compose add 1 to age, we have the output of 1. There's no longer an error message. Now, there are definitely more complex scenarios involving empty strings or potentially null values, in which case I'd actually look at an expression called coalesce, and I'll share the link to that particular expression, and I have used it in previous videos too. Let me know in the comments below what you've learned from today's video, if you'd like me to cover a future demonstration. And as always, please make sure you like and subscribe, and I look forward to seeing you again sometime soon. Thanks for watching. Cheers.